Let's summarize all the randomized complexity classes we have seen. We have seen RP, which has bounded error, false negatives, but no false positives. We have CoRP, which has bounded error, false positives, but no false negatives. We have BPP, which has bounded error and allows for both false negatives and false positives. And we have ZPP, which has no errors at all, but may answer, I don't know, with some bounded probability. We've discussed relationships between those classes. We've established that P is contained in RP, which is contained in NP, and that P is contained in CoRP, which is contained in CoNP. And we have seen that RP and CoRP are both contained in BPP, so therefore the union is also contained in BPP. And we have seen that the intersection of RP and CoRP is equal to ZPP, which is also known as expected polynomial time. We've also seen an example of a problem, namely polynomial identity testing, that is in CoRP, but which is not known to be in P. So it's an example of a problem that can be solved using randomization efficiently, but which we do not know how to solve deterministically in polynomial time. In general, it is important to remember that often randomized algorithms are easier and faster and more practical than deterministic algorithms. This isn't always true, of course, but it's not uncommon for a randomized algorithm to give a very nice, easy, clean solution to a problem. And if an algorithm is much easier to implement, for example, which sometimes randomized algorithms are, you're less likely to make a mistake when you implement it, and so on. So oftentimes, randomized algorithms have all kinds of advantages. Of course, they also have the disadvantage that sometimes you might get incorrect answers, or you have this situation where you don't really know what the answer is, the algorithm just says, I have no idea. Or we can also have the situation that the running time of the algorithm is only an expected polynomial time. But all of those problems are manageable for the most part, because we can use these probability amplification tricks to make the error probabilities very, very small. In fact, we can make them exponentially small. Even for safety-critical systems, you might be able to use randomized algorithms. And the reason is that if you know what you're doing, you can make the error probability of this algorithm so small that it's much smaller than the probability that something else will go wrong with the safety-critical system. For example, if you have a plane that you want to control, and you have some algorithm that helps with the control of the plane, and the probability that that algorithm fails is much, much, much lower than the probability that the wings will fall off the plane, then clearly fixing this algorithm to a deterministic one that never makes a mistake is probably not really necessary, because you have bigger problems with your plane. And in fact, you can make the error probability of your algorithm so small that it's even more likely, or much more likely, that something with the very computer you're running your algorithm on will go wrong. Maybe the computer will suddenly explode with some very small probability. But if that happens with a larger probability than your algorithm making a mistake, then probably your algorithm is fine. So don't be afraid of randomization. If you know what you're doing, randomization is a great tool. It can help you a lot to get easier, faster, better solutions to things. Don't run away from randomization just because you're afraid of it. Try to understand it and then use it when it is appropriate.